Admiral Thad Allen. I'm retired from the Coast Guard. I'm currently a part-time senior fellow at RAND. I taught at George Washington University last semester, and I speak with the Washington Speakers Bureau. One of the reasons I came to RAND was that I wanted to go someplace and take my time to consider what I was going to do in retirement. I didn't want to immediately go to a defense contractor. I wasn't going to go with one of the oil companies. It would be pretty tough to justify it to the public. So I thought if I went to a not-for-profit for a year and just kind of consider my options, that would be a good way for me to do some thinking, kind of look at my options and have a real measured way to consider my future. Probably the thing I've been involved in most are the studies they're doing on community resiliency in and around the Gulf Coast. Following Hurricane Katrina, RAND created a Gulf States Policy Institute in New Orleans. That was to look at the recovery process, but obviously the issues with the oil spill played into societal issues down there as well. And so we've been looking at the role of NGOs in community resilience, faith-based organizations. I've done a lot of outreach to those communities and worked with RAND on that. And also doing some work on port infrastructure, strategic planning for the Port of New Orleans, and just general issues regarding what I would call the resiliency of infrastructure as well. When you're involved in a leadership position with one of these large complex events and you have to process a lot of information and make decisions quickly under conditions of uncertainty with incomplete information, you kind of have to have a framework by which you do that. And over my lifetime, I've tried to develop that. One of the things I have always believed, that great leaders are great learners. And I've tried to engage in lifelong learning my entire life. And when I've had to dive pretty deeply into technical issues. For instance, when I was responding to the hurricane in New Orleans, there were issues about levee heights and what the Corps of Engineers was doing. I remember staying up till the middle of the night on the web looking up what a geodesic datum was. And so you have to be able to do some rapid learning based on the situation and absorb it very quickly. And the more you can do that, the more you're prepared to rapidly absorb information, then the better framework you're going to have by which to make decisions. I've told people for many, many years, you can always have a low probability, high consequence outcome based on a decision you make, or quote, a failure. And that's pretty tough in a zero tolerance for failure environment politically in the world we live in. But if you can explain after the fact the basis for your action and some kind of a model by which you assessed information, you're not talking about your behavior anymore, you're talking about the quality of information you had. That's a much, much different conversation. Well, I think leaders are faced with some pretty tough challenges in today's environment. The level of complexity in our world is increasing. Everything is linked in terms of global networks and so forth, and it can be very, very confusing and complex with the amount of information that's flying around, what you have to absorb to be able to lead and understand what's going on. I think if you start with the basics and first things first, and that's understanding the problem and what your task is and what your mission is, and then let everything flow to that, I think you're going to be in as good a shape as you can. And for the two events I was involved in, from a crisis standpoint, the hurricane and the oil spill response, I focused on one thing and one thing only, and that was creating unity of effort across the whole of government response when there were a lot of parochial interests involved, both politically, functionally, organizationally within government. You got to kind of subvert that and focus on what you're going to do. And then once you understand that, what are the empowering elements that allow you to actually achieve that unity of effort? And those are the types of things that I tend to focus on when I'm assigned one of these events. There's a model that's been developed by the National Preparedness Leadership Initiative up at the School of Public Health at Harvard. It's called Meta Leadership, and while there are a lot of different models out there, I'll use that one because it's a good basis for discussion. They identify five elements that you need to have when you're managing large complex events across multiple organizations. One of them is the ability to lead up, and that's the interaction between career and subject matter experts or technical folks like engineers with political leaders, which is always a very interesting interface. The second one is leading down, how you put a cadre around you, how you treat and support the people that are really trying to do the work. The third element is your ability to collaborate, network, and partner across stovepipe organizations to create unity of effort. The fourth and very interesting is really understanding the event or the problem you're trying to deal with and whether or not you've got it right. And that involves challenging assumptions, creating new mental models about what it is you're looking at, and the final element is yourself, how you lead yourself. That has a lot to do with emotional intelligence, empathy, and compassion, and how you keep your people on target and tasked and make sure that there's a set of values everybody's trying to aspire to create that unity of effort. Well, I think empathy and compassion is very, very important. If you can't demonstrate you understand the gravity with which people are reacting to an event, you're not going to represent them well in the response. Now, there's a nuance here. There's a difference between understanding the depth of their passion, their grief, and what's going on. But if you get to a point where you're so inconsolable about what happened that you're consumed with that, then you're not an effective part of the response. And so what I have tried to do both with the hurricane and the oil spill was recognize that there are issues out there in society. There are people that have been harmed by this. There are people that see their life, their way of life threatened. You can't denigrate that or say that's not true because it is. What you have to do is accept that, understand the passion of the local communities, and then understand that as part of the response, you have to reflect that passion. But you can't get so consumed with being angry at the event or somebody that you don't do the right thing. Yeah, my father was a retired chief petty officer in the Coast Guard, World War II vet. He actually had lied about his age and went in the Coast Guard when he was 16. He was part of a very large family of 10 kids that moved from Texas to Arizona during the Depression and the Dust Bowl days. They basically were pretty much itinerants. And he left home when he was between 14 and 15 years old because there wasn't a lot to eat. And he joined the Civilian Conservation Corps and lied about his age. And he was actually working on the Colorado River around Yuma and Parker, Arizona, when Pearl Harbor was bombed. And he went to the Coast Guard recruiter, lied about his age again, and went in when he was 16. He ultimately got out of the Coast Guard, had broken service, came back in when my mother was pregnant with me. I was born while he was underway on a Coast Guard cutter. And ultimately, he retired in 1965. And he passed away a few months ago, but to his great credit, he's always been a role model to me, but he got to see me promoted, become the commandant, and at each time, he was able to actually promote me himself and was there when I retired and retired me. Actually, I've been interviewed several times and people have asked me what they thought my legacy was going to be, and frankly, and all the engineers out there will appreciate this. I would like to believe that the structural changes I made to the maintenance logistics system in the Coast Guard were the most fundamental things I did as commandant. The hurricane response, the oil spill response, and some other things I've done have gotten a lot of notoriety, but I made a commitment coming in 2006 to change the entire business enterprise of the Coast Guard. We got a good deal of that done. A lot of it's still in progress, but a lot of folks out there will understand we have different levels of maintenance to support aircraft and vessels and so forth. And in the military, we have three levels of maintenance. They call it depot level, intermediate level, and unit level. I removed the entire middle organizational line from the Coast Guard, and I assigned every duty to either be organizational responsibility or assigned it to a depot. And we flattened the organization. We pushed a lot of information down to the people that needed to use it at the operating units, and fundamentally completely restructured the business enterprise of the Coast Guard. So when I look back at what I've done, I don't think about being on Face the Nation or Meet the Press or the Situation Room with Wolf Blitzer. I would like 15 years from now for folks to say, you know, he got it and he changed the Coast Guard before the budget pressure started to engage and created a more resilient modern Coast Guard that he found when he walked in the door. Well, I think most people would think it's easy to get overwhelmed with the gravity of the situation, the fact that you're in the middle of the eye of the storm, if you will, and you have a lot of media interest in what's going on. If you let that rent too much space in your head, or you become enamored with your role with the media, you're actually going to stop doing your job, and you're going to worry about the wrong things. What I try and do is focus on unity of effort and what we need to do to fix the problem, and then explain that very clearly to everybody. And it's been my experience that if you're frank and forthright with people, even about issues that nobody's crazy about talking about because they seem intractable or very complex, that you're going to be much better off in the long run. And over the course of the briefings and your interaction with the media, you'll build up a large amount of credibility that will help you in the response, and I've always tried to do that. I get a lot of questions about how do you talk to the press, how do you do that, and my answer is there's only one way you get good at doing media and television, and that's by doing it. Getting out there and practicing, making mistakes, and if you know your material and you're a subject matter expert and you're comfortable with the camera and you get past that, then you should go out there and be yourself and talk about what you know about. I discriminate about who I allow to rent space in my head. I can pretty much section things out and say, I understand that's important, I understand they're concerned about it, but for what I gotta do in the next 24 hours, I can't be worried about that and do my job. Rather than laying there and obsessing about the fact that somebody's got a problem with what I'm doing. Once I know what I'm going to do, I'll come back and I'll deal with them at a later point. But at some point, you gotta kind of block out the stuff that's not adding value to what you're doing right now, focus on what you're doing, then come back and deal with it later. And I call that letting somebody rent space in your head. I try not to do that. I believe for some time that we have to understand there's a fundamental change going on in our sociological ecosystem. I'm kind of mixing metaphors here, but if you look at what's going on in terms of the ubiquity of information, 24-hour news cycles, access to the internet, Facebook, Twitter, whatever, what we have is a way for people to aggregate and produce social behaviors without them being in each other's presence. That has huge implications for fraternal organizations, civic organizations, or professional organizations. Now you want to organize, reach out to these people and bring them in so you can add value to their lives and they can add value to the association. I've had a lot of conversations about how you bridge what are what I would call legacy organizations into the new way that people interact. I think we need to understand that this is the sociological equivalent of climate change. And I talk to a lot of groups about social media, which I've used extensively in later part of my career. And I have a lot of my peers, because they don't understand the technology and are not comfortable with that way of interacting with other people, either refuse to get involved or don't make very informed decisions on policy issues and investment issues related to technology. I think it's a huge issue with senior leadership today. But the problem is, and I'll quote John Holdren here, who's a science advisor to the president. He says we only have three choices on how we adapt to climate change. We can suffer, adapt, or manage. And I would submit to you that we have through three ways we can adapt to changes in the information, internet, and social media. We can suffer, we can adapt, or we can manage. And when I talk to folks that are my age and they don't get it, I take them back to the great movie that was made last year, The King's Speech. And I ask them all, what was the big problem in that movie? And I get a lot of different answers, you know. It was his inability to speak, it was the war and all that kind of stuff. And I said, no. The problem was radio. There was a new technology, everybody was using it, and he could not avoid using that means and medium of communication as a leader. Whether or not he was good at it or not, he did not have any choice. That's where we're at now.